Free agency is a risk versus reward scenario. Teams go all in hopes of either building a cup contender or just filling up the holes in their lineup. However, going all in means teams are willing to pay the big bucks for the big name free agents, and this strategy often leads to a lackluster outcome or, very rarely, a steal of a deal. In this case, however, almost every team that signed a big name free agent ended up paying the price, as this free agent class would go down as one of the worst in NHL history. Before we begin, I want to give a huge shout out to SeatGeek for sponsoring today's video. SeatGeek is an app that allows users to purchase tickets to games, concerts, and live events. SeatGeek makes buying tickets simple as they rate them on a scale of 1 to 100. The higher the number, the better the deal. So if you haven't already, use my promo code IDGT at checkout to save $20 off your first purchase. Now, let's get into it. Every offseason, the media releases an article previewing the upcoming free agent class and then ranks them based on value. Well, I found one of those articles, and we'll be using this list to go over just how bad the class really was. Keep in mind, we'll only be going over the contracts that somehow managed to be worse than the ones handed out. We'll start from the bottom and work our way to the top. With that being said, let's start in Toronto. Ranked as the 28th best free agent on the market, Matt Martin wasn't actually a bad player. It was a terminated deal that landed Martin on this list. Martin was signed by the Leafs to a 2-year, $2.5 million deal and was expected to do the usual, play a bottom six role and provide grit to protect young guys on the team. Martin as a Leaf would rack up respectable numbers for the role he played. In 132 games, he would tally 21 points, but the Leafs would eventually trade Martin back to the Islanders in a successful attempt to sign the big fish in the free agent market and John Tavares years later. This is a prime example of why you shouldn't blame the players for signing these contracts, as Martin was solid, but it was his term that sent them packing and landed him on the list. Ranked number 24, Joel Colburn practically vanished in plain sight. After having a career year in Calgary, people were beginning to buy into Colburn's hype. And coming free agency, the Avalanche took the bait and then signed him to a 2-year, $2.5 million deal. Colburn would only have one memorable moment before seemingly disappearing from the league. A hat trick in his first game. Besides that, it was really it. Colburn would go from being in the league to being in the AHL and then disappearing in the blink of an eye. However, Colburn did face a few injuries, and that could have led to his demise, but this deal was only good for about 60 minutes, as after that hat trick, Colburn would only score one more goal and rack up four more assists. It's a shame, as Colburn looked very promising in Calgary and was still fairly young. Ranked number 22, Jason Demers is interesting. I want to point out what the article states, as I feel this perfectly fits and describes what happened so far. The article states, quote, "Demers is a solid depth addition, but a team that pays him like a top pairing guy might end up disappointed." The Panthers would end up giving Demers a 5-year, $4.5 million deal, and Demers would only last a season before getting traded to Arizona, where Demers has been a, you guessed it, solid depth guy. Demers' point total has also dipped year by year, and slowly as well, going from 28 to 20 and then 8. However, he's still been pretty solid defensively, so there isn't really much to point out about Demers, as the article pretty much predicted and summarized his time in Arizona. He's a depth, reliable defenseman who got paid like a semi-top pairing guy. Number 13 on the list is similar to Demers, but he's actually had a pretty cool revival story at the moment. James Reimer was the starting goalie for the Leafs until getting traded to San Jose at the deadline. Reimer would have a strong showing and made teams believe he could be a starting goaltender elsewhere. The Panthers decided to play Reimer as backup to veteran Roberto Luongo, and they inked him into a 5-year, $3.4 million deal. The term and dollar value seemed a bit risky, but at the time, Reimer had a lot of interest. Reimer would do fairly well, but his win-loss ratio didn't accumulate to starting type numbers. After 3 years in Florida, the Panthers would trade Reimer to Carolina as a cap dump to sign Sergei Bobrovsky, and as of now, Reimer's had a record of 14-6-2 with a .914 save percentage and a .266 goals against average. Reimer's always been solid, but his contract is not the best. Now that we've gotten to the semi-bearable contracts, let's move on to the horrendous contracts. And these are the worst of the worst. The funny thing about it is that these contracts belong to the guys who are supposed to be the best of the best. Ranked number 12th on the list, Troy Brouwer was brought into Calgary to help bolster up the physicality and help the Flames become more of a contender. He did the exact opposite. Brouwer had 7 straight seasons in which he racked up 30 or more points prior to the signing, and this intrigued the Flames, a team that needed scoring depth and offensive help. Not only could Brouwer potentially provide that, but he also had some serious playoff experience after his time in Chicago. However, Brouwer was on the wrong side of 30, and it showed. The Flames would ink Brouwer to a 4-year, $4.6 million deal, and the term was surprising considering Brouwer would be 31 by season end. Troy's numbers would begin to drop, going from 25 to 22 before getting bought out by the Flames only 2 years into his contract. Brouwer is now back in St. Louis after being dropped by the Panthers and has a cheaper team-friendly deal, but only has 1 point in 13 games with the Blues. Father Time is undefeated. Ranked 9th on the list is Mikhail Bodker, and this was surprising. Bodker was always hyped up to be a goal scorer who just needed another guy around him in order to showcase his true potential. During his time in Arizona and a brief stint in Colorado, Bodker would produce 2 50 plus point seasons in a span of 4 years, so once the market opened up, Bodker's point total and offensive upside intrigued a lot of teams. The Sharks would end up expressing the most interest, adding him to the team's stacked forward core. Bodker would receive a huge payday and also a huge stay as well, as he would get signed to a 4-year, $4 million deal. The hope was that for Bodker to finally be able to unlock that hidden potential he's been hyped up to have, but that wasn't the case. In fact, Bodker's point total would begin to derail quickly. He'd go from putting up 51 points the year prior to only tallying 26 in his first season. He'd try to make up for it next season with 37 points, but the Sharks need cap space and ship Mikhail off to Ottawa, and Bodker's continued to produce the same way he did in San Jose. The Sharks let the hype get to him, and it didn't pay off. Ranked number 8 on the list, Franz Nielsen. Nielsen is known for having one of the best records in NHL shootout history, and that's about it. The Hockey News stated that Nielsen, quote, is an underrated fit for any team's middle six forward group. Middle six meaning borderline bottom six. Nielsen was always a guy who would give you solid hockey, but not a guy that would be one of your main point producers, and he was also 32 at the time, so relatively on the older side. You expect a team to offer him a 2-year deal at max, right? Well, after Franz had 2 50-point seasons in 3 years, Detroit wanted him so badly that they signed the lifelong Islander to a 6-year deal worth $5.25 million. Detroit thought they could still contend for the playoffs and keep the streak alive, but that doesn't give you an excuse to sign someone to a deal that won't end until they're 38 years old. Holland flopped on this one, and so did Nielsen. His production would drop yearly, even though racking up 30 points in his last two seasons. He's only got 7 this year on a historically bad Red Wings team. So to drop 20 points a year and play a middle six role, the only one who benefited from this deal was Nielsen himself. Sixth on the list is the lovable Louis Erickson. Erickson was having a pretty good revival at the time, actually. After boasting 47 points the year prior, Erickson would hit the market after tallying 63 points in 82 games, so you could see why people were highly interested in acquiring Erickson that year. But once again, Erickson was going to be over 30 years old the following season, so offering tons of terms shouldn't be a good idea. But the Canucks don't learn anything and say, screw it. Let's sign Erickson to a 6-year deal worth $6 million. You're banking high on Erickson. They really thought his production would continue into the 60-point range and that they could play him alongside the Sedin twins, but boy were they wrong. Erickson scored in his first game with the team, however, for the other team, and would fall off from there. He went from 63 points to 24 that year and hasn't recovered since. This season, he's only got 12 points at the halfway mark. Not a good look. Another flop. Ranked one higher in the top 5 free agents on the market was Andrew Ladd. Ladd actually had a lot of interest that year. He was a huge success in Chicago and even in Winnipeg, so teams were hoping Ladd still had his offensive touch. The Islanders were a team looking for some scoring help and signed Ladd to a horrendous 7-year deal worth $5.25 million. This is also ignoring the fact that Ladd was already showing signs of declining after going from a 62-point to 46-point season before the market opened. Ladd would only get worse from there. His production would drop drastically yearly, and it became so bad to the point that Ladd had to become a healthy scratch and was sent down to the minors at times to save Islanders cap space. Ladd is currently back in the AHL, and the 2 games he has played this year, he produced nothing. Also, how the hell did the Wild almost trade one of their most productive guys in Zach Parise for this dude? Kinda blew my mind, but that's besides the point. Ladd was a complete bust, and his contract is still on the books for a while. Have fun, Long Island. Fourth on the list is All-Star Milan Lucic. Man, one of the best players on the market flew off a cliff. Lucic's age caught up to him, had become slow as dirt, and had turned into a pure tipping machine. He'll also fight once in a while, but that's about it. His cap hit also makes things 10 times worse, as the Oilers of Shirelli would pull a Shirelli and inked Lucic to a 7-year deal with a hefty contract. And believe it or not, Lucic in his first year actually showed some promise, as he did tally 50 points in a full season. But after that, Lucic just dipped. From 30 to 20, Lucic's stats dropped off faster than his play on the ice did, and he became slow and relied on his grit and physicality to keep him on the roster. What's still crazy is that the Flames actually decided to trade this guy and give up James Neal in a one-for-one deal that would also include a potential conditional pick headed Calgary's way. Neal has had a semi-revival season, but has been hurt as of now. And as for Lucic, he's actually been solid with Ryan and Dubé, but his point total is still slacking, and that contract hurts regardless if some of it was retained. Third place on the list belongs to David Backes, and it's a sad story how quickly he fell off. Backes was considered to be one of the biggest fish on the market, so teams are bound to overpay, but not to the extent that they did. The Bruins, out of everyone, ended up signing Backes, which didn't really add up unless they were looking on him solely for leadership. But clearly they were hoping for his offensive talents to make a mark, as they signed the man to a 5-year, $6 million deal with a modified no-trade clause. And it's obvious things haven't panned out so far. Backes went from playing in the lineup to then becoming a healthy scratch before eventually becoming an AHLer and a plug in whichever spot was open on the bottom six. Backes started to rely solely on his physicality to help him remain in Boston until this season, when he was traded to Anaheim for Andre Kasha as a cap dump. Backes, between injuries and barely making the lineup, was one of the biggest flops of the class. Finally, the last player on the list, ranked at number 2, Kyle Okposo, is a case of horrible luck. Okposo had promise and went to Buffalo on a pretty hefty 7-year, $7 million deal. However, unlike most of these guys spoken about, Okposo was still in his semi-younger side. You could see how this could work? Well, keep in mind he also signed to Buffalo, and even working alongside Jack Eichel couldn't help his case. He looks like he doesn't fit out on the ice, like he needs a new change of scenery, and his stats have shown this as well. Between the injuries and decline, the term and deal seem regrettable now. However, I do believe that if he can somehow get moved, he could have some sort of revival. Out of all the big fish in the market that year, 2 were in the AHL, 6 have been traded, and 2 were bought out, and 1 left the league completely. It's insane to see just how bad a free agent class can really be. This was the definition of buyer's remorse, as the majority of these teams are still facing the consequences to those signings, and all it took was one contract, signature, and a whole lot of potential to change the course of the league and go down in history for all the wrong reasons.